The leader of the Labour Party, Jeremy Corbyn.
Thank you, Diane, and thank you very much for that introduction. Thank you to you, Diane, for all you do as our Deputy Shadow Secretary, but also the brilliant way this morning, in a very short space of time, you brought the reality of working class history alive to this audience in this wonderful People's History Museum here. Because this is a place that is redolent of the history of struggle, the history of solidarity, and the history of sacrifice to bring about that solidarity. Because those workers that boycotted slave products, be they sugar or cotton, suffered grievously as a result of it. They too went hungry in order that the slaves would one day be free and they themselves would not go hungry either. They understood that international solidarity is what is so important and matters so much. And to Kate, thank you very much for all you do as our Shadow Equality Secretary to bring reality to the fight to end the gender pay gap, to bring reality to the fight to bring real opportunities for everybody in our society, ending discrimination once and for all. And to Alan, thank you for all you do, all the bus miles you've taken in this campaign, and all the work you've put in to try to ensure that a clear, identifiable Labour message has got over in this campaign. A Labour message of the kind of Britain we want to live in. A Labour message of the kind of continent and Europe that we want to live in. Which isn't based on free markets, which isn't based on exploitation, but is based on improving the living standards of all that we might all benefit. Thank you, Alan. Thank you, Diane. Thank you, Ken, for all that you do. I want to say also thank you to this museum, because I know it's struggled to be established. Indeed, I was a trustee of the early National Museum of Labour History, going back a very long way. And it's now got a real home here in the Northwest, and I'm very proud of that, because it brings reality to the importance of our youngsters being brought up understanding that the rights we have, the health service we enjoy, all those things didn't come by accident. They weren't gifts from on high. They were the product of the Labour movement struggling for the equality and justice for all. Those principles are for all time, and we should never be ashamed to say what our principles are. That is what makes us different from every other political party. And I just say to the government very gently, when you're funding issues of national heritage and national museums, the Labour movement's history is as much a part of our heritage as any other national museum. Yesterday in Parliament was a very, very sad day. A very sad day because we lost one of our own. Jo Cox was brutally murdered in her own constituency whilst doing what all MPs do, advice bureaus, talking to our constituents, supporting them through difficulties in difficult times. She was murdered, and that murder was a loss for her, a loss for her children, a loss for her husband, a loss for her parents, a loss for her entire community, a loss for our entire movement. And it was an attack on our democracy. An attack on our democracy that's taken one person because somebody believed it was their duty or whatever to do it. I don't know what the circumstances are going to pan out on that. But I do know this, that in her memory of all those people that stand up for justice, stand up for democracy, stand up and poke their head above the parapet, sometimes when it's difficult, we stand in solidarity with Jo and her family. And in her memory, we campaign as never before for that decent, just society that respects all and doesn't allow the disfigurement of racism or discrimination to divide us. United, we are very strong. Divided, we are very weak. Solidarity to Jo and her family. And I've been deeply moved by the messages I've received as leader of the party from socialists and trade unionists all over the world who are shocked and appalled what happened to Joe, and just ask me to convey that message to everyone, their thoughts. They've come from Chile, they've come from America, they've come from many parts of Africa and Asia and many other places. And what better place to convey that than in the People's History Museum here. So I thank all of those, and I thank all of you for the solidarity you all showed over the past few days during these desperate, difficult days. In Joe's memory, we carry on. This week, there's going to be a very important vote, just 48 hours away, as Diane explained. And I want to make it very clear. The Labour position is that we are for a Remain vote, for staying in. One of the major reasons for this is about jobs and workers' rights. We're in this building today, which demonstrates how many of those rights were. We live in a very globalised world. The battles that we fight as a Labour movement have never been confined just to national borders, but this time they are more global than they've ever been before. Workers, capital and corporations move across borders. That reality will carry on, whatever the vote on Thursday. That free movement of people is important, but only by remaining and working together with our allies across Europe can we regulate those flows and improve things for working people in Britain at the same time as improving lives for working people all across this continent. It was a Labour government that in 1970, under Barbara Castle's brilliant tutelage, introduced the Equal Pay Act. That was a product of the work of women trade unionists, not least women workers at Ford's in Dagenham, who took strike action in 1968. For equal pay, and many others that had taken action for equal pay. The Act was a very, very important step forward. It didn't result in equal pay immediately. There was still a long way to go on that. And 14 years later, it was the use of an EU directive which ensured it was strengthened, not just in this country, but across Europe, meaning that we got equal pay for work of equal value. There is still a gender pay gap. There is still a long way to go, but it was an important step forward, and by working with colleagues all across the continent, we managed to achieve a big step forward, and I believe we can make further steps forward. There was at one time no limit on working time for workers in Britain until, again, trade union action and support across the continent brought in the Working Time Directive, which also provided for rest breaks. Our rights to annual leave were underpinned by the European Union, by action again taken by colleagues, MEPs and many others all across Europe. Otherwise, we would not have the right to 28 days leave without that membership. For too many people in Britain today, work is still very insecure. We cannot be content with the status quo. We want to stop this level of insecurity at work and the exploitation of zero-hours contracts. Zero-hours contracts are something that is really important. How can you plan your life if you don't know how many hours you're going to work? You don't know what your income is going to be. But you do know you've got to pay your rent every week. You do know you've got to feed yourself and your family every week. You do know you've got to pay gas bills, electricity bills, and all the other bits and pieces that you have to pay to keep life going. And you don't know what your income is going to be. Therefore, you have to try and access DWP support, and the complications on a zero-hours contract of managing any kind of life or budget are very, very complicated. So why is it in Britain we allow these things to happen? I want us to be campaigning to eliminate zero-hours contracts in Britain and all across the continent. Indeed, they're not permitted in Austria, Belgium, the Czech Republic, Denmark, France, Germany, Hungary, Italy, Netherlands, Poland and Spain. Now, I know David Cameron likes to be the odd one out, but he certainly is the odd one out. How about taking a leaf out of the book of all those countries and ending, once and for all, zero-hours contracts? As well as undoing these contracts, should go further and work with allies across Europe to establish a minimum standard of rights at work, to stop the undercutting and give people job security that they need. Germany has introduced a minimum wage, and there is now an opportunity to establish a European-wide minimum wage based on the cost of living in different countries. That would increase workers' pay in many places all across the continent. These things are now achievable because Germany was the last one not to bring in a minimum wage, or last one of the major economies. There is a little known directive called the Posting of Workers Directive. Now, Alan, don't get excited. This is absolutely nothing to do with the post office and absolutely nothing to do with postal workers and the overtime they get delivering European leaflets. Important as that is, and I hope they've got lots of overtime on this occasion. What it does is enables companies that win contracts in another part of Europe to take their workers to work in other countries. They can post their workers abroad temporarily rather than going through a new recruitment process. Legal judgments have opened up loopholes, meaning that these companies are able to undermine the going rate in one country by paying the going rate in another. In extreme cases, it's meant that workers not being paid the minimum wage for the country they're working in because it is above the rate of their home nation. Obviously, that leads to the grotesque levels of exploitation that are happening in many places across this region, indeed across the whole country, by unscrupulous employers exploiting migrant workers, undercutting workers here, forcing unemployment here and poverty wages for those migrant workers. Surely the solution to that is a sense of solidarity of all of us to force those employers to pay proper wages in the country where they're operating their business. And that is something we want to achieve, to close that loophole. So we would force an union to secure an agreement to back this loophole so that no longer could this, this exploitation go on. So we campaign for better rights at work across whole continent. The only way to stop the race to the bottom on jobs and wages is actually to work together across our continent to raise standards for all. That's what we did with the rights for agency workers, for part-time workers, and on so many other issues. The social chapter is a very important part of the European agreements. And this has actually helped us to improve the lives of quite a lot people in this country. 26 million workers in Britain benefit from being entitled to 28 days paid leave and a living on how many hours they can be forced to work. Do you think all of those 26 million would get 4 weeks paid holiday a year if we didn't have it enshrined in law? I am very sure they would not. And I'm very sure that there are many employers that would like to go to the US norm of 2 weeks holiday per year rather than the European norm of 4 weeks per year. These things are actually practical and very, very important. 8 million part-time workers, 6 million of whom are women, have equal rights with full-time colleagues, again, because of our victory in winning those regulations. 1 million temporary workers have the same rights as permanent workers. 340,000 women every year have guaranteed rights to take maternity leave. These things are very important. It's important to understand the benefit of these gains. It means workers throughout Europe have decent rights at work, meaning it's harder to undercut terms and conditions across the continent. Several Leave supporters have stated clearly that they want to leave Europe to water down workers' rights, to rip up the protections that protect work-life balance, that prevent discrimination and prevent exploitation and injustice. And it's a bit odd when you've got an employment minister who announces that the first thing she wants to do on Friday, if there is a leave vote, is to tear up at least half of the employment regulations. I think they should tell us which half it is. Is it the holidays? Is it the maternity leave? Is it the paternity leave? Is it the end of discrimination against people for their gender or their sexuality? Which particular regulations is it that they find so offensive that have done so much to improve the lives of so many people in this country? There's still 2 days to go. There's still time for us to tell us which regulations they want to tear up on Friday morning or in the weeks, months and years to come, if unfortunately they're able to win this referendum. It's a Tory-led Brexit campaign that is a real threat to working people in this country. So I say, we remain to fight, we remain to improve living conditions and standards all across the continent with people who think, work and act just like us, who might happen to have a different nationality or speak a different language. 3 million jobs in Britain are linked to trade with Europe. That's why the major manufacturers and all the major trade unions are concerned and want to remain within Europe. It's not only jobs with a direct link to Europe that are at risk, the whole economy is threatened by a potential downturn. So whatever you feel about the European Union, we should not lightly be prepared to put those jobs at risk. Our economy is fragile and insecure because we've had 6 years of Tory-led austerity, weakened wages, weakened rights at work, and weakened job security. We know who gets laid off when there is a downturn. It's the young workers, the insecure workers, those most recently hired are often the first out. We know who gets hit hardest by any downturn. It's the working class communities with the lowest level of income. We know that it's a Tory government that has cut government support for local authorities hardest in the poorest areas of this country. The biggest cut in local authority support for any local authority is in Britain's poorest borough, that is Knowsley. They've had the biggest cut. The least cuts have taken place in the wealthiest, most leafiest parts of this country. We know what the Tories are about. We know what they're doing. And so a vote to leave, in my view, risks more Tory austerity and more of the wrong choices, because the negotiations would be led by the Tory right, cheered on by Nigel Farage and UKIP. That is the agenda they're setting. That is the danger to living standards and so much that we value within our society. They won't pay for any downturn with tax increases on the wealthy or big corporations, but with cuts to the public services that we know, likes of Nigel Farage and his disgusting poster and the xenophobic message that he puts forward. We are better than that, we are stronger than that, and united we can defeat the threats that they are posing to every family in this country. Migrants that come here, they work here, they earn their pay here, and they pay their taxes here. Many EU migrants, 52,000 of them, work in our National Health Service. 10% of all our doctors, 5% of all our nurses, and many, many other highly skilled workers within our National Health Service. Many more work in other public services, educating our children, caring for our elderly, and helping to run our public transport. They've also established businesses here, provided jobs for people in this country, and paying taxes. And indeed, there are more than 1 million British people doing exactly the same in other parts of Europe, working there, teaching there, researching, and many others. And there are another 800,000 British people working on jobs for a year, 2 years, or whatever, across Europe. That actually helps cross-fertilisation of ideas. It helps the cultural development of all of us. Parties like UKIP whip up divisions, emphasise problems, but offer no solutions. Identifying problems is not enough. Its politicians have to resolve them. And I simply say to those that spend too much time listening to those people, prejudice, nastiness and racism never built a house, never educated a child, never trained a nurse, never trained a doctor, never provided a university place. It's only intelligent thought coming together and investing in people and public services that brings us a better society, working together. We all ultimately rely on each other. Housing is in short supply, basically because governments haven't built enough. Since the 1980s, we've been selling off council housing without replacement, and today, house building is at the lowest level since the 1920s. The solution to the housing crisis is to build more houses, is to provide secure council tenancies. It's not the Housing Act that's going to solve any of those things, and to regulate the private rented sector. Our National Health Service is in record deficit due to, in part, the top-down reorganisation and the underfunding. They've also cut social care for the elderly and disabled, bursaries for nurses and midwives, and mental health budgets. They've allowed NHS trusts to dedicate more resources to be used to treat private patients and failed to train enough nurses and doctors. So we now have to rely on many others to come in and help us. They're welcome and they're appreciated, but we also need to do far more to develop good training schemes for nurses, doctors and everyone else. So far from being a burden on our National Health Service, it's actually migrant workers that are saving it. You're more likely to be treated by an EU migrant in hospital than be laying in your bed with somebody in the next bed who is also from Europe. Our schools are about to suffer the largest budget cut since the 1970s. Yet there is a teacher shortage and class sizes rising. Instead of finding money to solve this, the Tory government gave a tax break to benefit the richest 5%, whilst at the same time making the first cut in schools' budgets for more than 30 years. It is a disgrace. Wrong choices, wrong time, and always looking for someone else to blame. And so, where there is an effect of life migration into a community, stretching public services, GPs, housing, then there has to be an answer to that. It's not to blame people, it's to look for a solution. In 2008, the then Labour government, led by Gordon Brown, established a migrant impact fund, which was providing £50 million a year in support to communities in the areas that were most affected. It was the Cameron government in 2010, in that first budget, that abolished that fund. I want to see fair funding for local authority, so we don't end up hitting Knowsley, Liverpool and Manchester hardest across this country. Instead, we provide the best support needed for the areas most in need. But we also reinstate and indeed expand the Migrant Impact Fund, so that support is there for extra school places, for extra GP surgeries, and all the things that we need so that everybody can benefit from good quality public services. But if you want to find the main reason for our public services struggling, think about it. It's actually the Tory government and the austerity policies that they've been following. And so, as we come down towards the 23rd, Thursday's decision is very crucial. Ask yourself this question. What's best for jobs in this country, rights at work, and our future prosperity? We're faced with a choice. Do we remain to protect jobs and prosperity in Britain, or do we step into an unknown future with a Leave and a Tory negotiated Brexit, started with a bonfire of employment rights and many other rights that we have? I want to live in a society where there is full employment, where there are rights at work, and where we as a society defend, not tear up, our human rights and work with people all across this continent to try and achieve the same thing. The humanitarian crisis should be dealt with humanity, not with aggression, not with xenophobia, not with nastiness. It should be dealt with in that way. So I hope we'll realise that by standing together and asking for a Remain vote on Thursday, it gives us the chance to reform the European Union. It certainly needs reform in many ways. But it gives us the chance to work with others across the continent who are facing much the same problems. So we don't give in to global corporations and global movements of capital. Instead, we support and defend the welfare state we've got, the kind of society we want to live in, and we're stronger by doing it with people across the continent working with us. So let's unite together to try and make the EU a better place and try to make this country a better place at the same time. That is the Labour message. We've come to that conclusion after much debate and much thought. And I believe it's in the traditions of our movement that we link up with people across this continent. We've achieved quite a lot together. We've got a lot of jobs dependent on it. But there's a danger if we leave that all those things will be put at risk and we'll be having to mount a massive campaign to defend what we've got rather than demand something better for the next generation. I want us to be able to say to the next generation, you're not going to inevitably be poorer than this generation. You're not inevitably going to have worse education, worse health service, worse pensions than this generation. I want us to be able to say to the next generation, you should benefit from the incredible levels of technology and science that that is available for all of us, that technology should be a tool for the redistribution of wealth, not the concentration of wealth in the hands of the few. That's the Labour message. Vote for Remain, vote for Remain for reform, vote for Remain to ensure better standards of living for all of us and a real sense of human rights and humanity across the whole continent. Thank you very much.